I want to welcome you today. Our session is entitled Empowering Children's Development, Navigating Early Intervention and Special Education Processes for Optimal Care and Support. Bottom line is we want to be there for young children. And if we notice that a child is not developing the way they typically should be, we want to be able to, you know, support families and ultimately support children and making sure they receive the services that they do need to thrive and succeed and do their best in the school system and in life in general. My name is Cynthia Parker. I will be running the session today. I've been in the early childhood field for about 28 years or so. I might have hit 29 now. And I have two children of my own, grown children. My master's degree is in special education, but I can say that I've gone through this process in terms of being on the side of the educator and, you know, conducting the documentation and communicating with parents and, you know, saying, hey, I think this is the right step. We really should talk about having your child evaluated. These are some concerns that we see. I've also been on the parent side of things where I've gone through the process with my own children. And so, you know, I think we need to keep all of the roles in mind in terms of, yes, this can be difficult for you as the educator because the various needs children may have in a classroom setting, but it is just as difficult for the parents and is just as difficult for children going through this. So how can we all work together to do what's in the best interest of the child? So in our session today, we're going to talk about documenting children's development and behavior. That's the start. That's the most important piece of this whole process here, because as an early childhood educator, this is what can really get parents to understand what's going on with their child and can be the support as they go and speak with their pediatrician or early intervention or whomever else is supporting their family. So making sure that you have good documentation tools. We're also talking about communicating your concerns with parents. Not an easy job. Sometimes parents are very open. Other parents might kind of put up that wall because this is very overwhelming and concerning to them and they're not really sure where to go. And so they may freeze a little bit in the process. And lastly, understanding the evaluation process. So what does it look like to have a child go through that early intervention process to see if they qualify for services or that public school special education process? There's many steps, but it is clearly laid out what should be happening and when. And so if you know that information, it can help ease up some of that anxiety for both you, the family, and the child. All right, so let's get started. When we're talking about disabilities that children may have in your classroom, there are some that are easily identified. You know that if a child comes into your classroom and they have hearing aids in, that there is some sort of hearing disability. You can tell if they are using any other type of adaptive furniture or crutches or walkers and so forth, that there's something happening that they need support in order to continue their development. But not all disabilities are visible. And that can be where it gets especially emotional, I feel, because we don't really know how to respond to a child. Is this just a behavioral issue? Is this just, you know, learn behavior because they are, you know, get what they want at home or at the grandparents' house? Or is there more to it? Is there more going on and this child is really struggling and it's coming out in a really negative way in the classroom and you're trying to figure out what it is? And it sometimes gets to the point where you definitely need to reach out to parents and say, this child needs more than what I can offer on my own. So I'm asking you to work with me. I'm asking you to find other supports that can work with your child and support them, hopefully in this classroom setting. So when we're talking about disabilities, there's all different types of disabilities. Again, it may be a physical disability like cerebral palsy or multiple sclerosis. Again, a brain injury may be caused by an accident or something of that sort. There might be intellectual disabilities, autism, Down syndrome, fetal alcohol syndrome. Those are the ones that I feel as though I read more up on. Mental health disabilities, I think that's a huge topic in this day and age. Depression and anxiety are just two of those, but Mental health is in the forefront now, I think, in education, and rightfully so, because there are so many children out there struggling with their mental health, and it's being better recognized and better supported nowadays. There's also sensory disabilities. That also, autism can fall within that, because that sensory integration challenge is oftentimes a characteristic within autism. It could be a hearing impairment, or again, just sensory processing disorder in and of itself. And there are learning disabilities as well, such as dyslexia or dyscalculia, something that is specifically impeding a part or a way in which a child is learning. Here are some facts, and you know, I always find them a bit surprising as these numbers just seem to grow and grow. In 2018, the most prevalent disability category of children ages 3 to 5 served under IDEA Part B, which is the special education, usually that preschool services. The number one was speech and language impairment. The next most common disability category was developmental delay, followed by autism. To me, these aren't really surprising. I feel as though as children are getting older, they move so fast and develop so many skills between birth through 5 that a lot of times, you know, we can watch a child and say, okay, let's keep an eye on them. You know, they might just need a little more time to, you know, develop these skills and so forth. But language, think about it. Language really is something that we watch right from birth in terms of the sounds that children make, the comprehension, the babbling. My granddaughter is now 14 months old and she doesn't have her first word yet. Usually, you know, by now you'd have at least one word. She doesn't have that yet. So she actually is receiving early intervention services for speech. And that started because she actually was receiving services for torticollis, which is kind of that next muscle area here that doesn't necessarily stretch out, which then can delay other motor development. And as she grew out of that, she was fortunate to already be in services and now can just move right into receiving speech services without another evaluation process. So I feel like that's such an early on developmental phase that we see in young children that it's one of the ones that jumps out most. And I oftentimes feel that it's also one of the more comfortable areas for parents to go seek support on, because they want their child talking and so forth. When it becomes to other behavioral or other types of disabilities, that's where it can definitely be more difficult for parents to accept. A couple other facts here. In 2020 to 2021, the number of students, now we're talking ages 3 to 21, receiving special education services was 7.2 million, or 15% of public school students. For this collection of data, the most common category of disability was a specific learning disability. So again, dyslexia, dyscalculia, all of those very specific diagnoses that can affect the way a child learns to read or comprehends, or you know, can manipulate numbers and letters. And this is that breakdown from that same gathering of information here to see what percentage of students are categorized under what type of disability. So again, you can see specific learning disability is right up there. Speech and language is the second. So between that 3 and 5, it's that number one category, as you are getting across the ages for children from ages 3 to 21, it moves down to number 2. I've also seen some statistics that say 15% isn't actually the number, that 17% actually better represents the number of children diagnosed with a disability. So that's a huge number of children. So if you think of every classroom, you know, even averaging 20 children in your classroom, about 4 of them have potentially a disability. You know, so that means most of you have classrooms where you are engaged with children with some sort of disability, whether it is diagnosed or not. And then in 2018, numbers showed that 409,315 infants and toddlers, meaning birth through age 2 to 2.9, served under IDEA Part C, which is early intervention, were receiving services. And that is 3.5% of children birth through age 2. So up to like that 2.9 where they would move into public school services. So that's still a large number. One of the most important things I always like to make sure I include in special education webinars or workshops is that as an educator, your role is to share your observations and compare them to developmental norms when you're communicating to parents. It is not to diagnose children. And I say that because I've seen that happen where teachers may be concerned about behaviors or delays that they're noticing, and they may share with families, you know, oh, I think that child may have, you know, autism. I think that child may have a speech and language disorder. I think that may have ADHD. And if you're not formally trained in diagnosing children with various disabilities, you should not be sharing that information with parents, because we can set them up for a whole roller coaster of emotions, because we may be right, we may not be. And you may get parents really starting to have some tunnel vision, thinking, nope, this is what my child's teacher says. We have this great, you know, relationship and so forth. But we need to let the experts who are conducting the evaluations on children do the diagnosis so that the child receives the appropriate supports that they need. Okay. And just one really quick example of why this is, why I always emphasize this point, is that the characteristics that you see happening with a child in your classroom that you might be concerned about may be a very common characteristic that falls under ADHD. But the reality is that if you were to look up all the various disabilities within, you know, intellectual disabilities or mental health disabilities, a lot of those characteristics overlap. And I'm using this example right here of fetal alcohol syndrome disorder, autism, and depression. Well, one simple characteristic, such as lack of eye contact, falls within all of these diagnoses. And so we don't want to say, oh, definitely lack of eye contact, I am really concerned this might be autism, because that's what we associate it most with for many of us. But noting lack of eye contact is important, but not connecting it to a diagnosis at this point. Okay. Again, allowing the professionals to do that is key. Now, when we are trying to understand what's going on with children, it's not an easy process. So this idea that it's a puzzle that we have to help families put together is, you know, a good thought process in terms of not jumping to conclusions, kind of ruling things in, ruling things out, and again, getting great documentation for families. So when we have a concern with children, first we have to stop and think, well, is it a medical or physical issue? You know, we should always ask, could there be something physically causing a child to behave the way they are, or be delayed in an area of development? Now, an example of this might be for my son. He always had stomach aches growing up, always had stomach aches. And for years, we associated it with some of his anxiety. So we thought, nope, this is all mental health. This is, you know, he's not really having stomach aches. It's all in his mind. It's all connected to anxiety. Come to find out, he actually had a lactose intolerance. So yes, I think some of those stomach aches in that elementary school when I got a call from the nurse saying he's down here could be from his anxiety. But we also found out that dairy was causing a lot of that too. And if we don't double check that there aren't any physical things going on with the child, we could be missing out on, you know, a quick support for that child, or giving them the wrong support. There are developmental stages we have to think about. The easiest example here is thinking about children who might be biting. So if you have a 2-year-old in a classroom who is biting all of the time, No, this is not socially acceptable, but it may be developmentally typical because children in that age span may go through a stage of biting for various reasons. That's a whole other workshop. However, if you have a five-year-old in a classroom who is biting other children, now that usually goes outside the normal range of development. That would be more of a red flag to say, hey, most five-year-olds are not biting. There's something really going on that's causing this. That's not just a developmental stage. There's also temperament, and we're all born with a certain temperament. Mine tends to be a very outgoing, dominant, fast-paced style. And if you have a child who has a similar temperament to maybe mine and is feeling frustrated in the classroom, they're going to be the child who is probably having meltdowns when they don't get their way or bossing around all the other children in the classroom. And before we start to think about, again, something being wrong with this child, we have to think about, wow, are we really creating an environment that is supporting their temperament and their personal needs? You know, are we allowing a child to be able to make decisions and have some sense of control in their own life with that type of personality? Whereas other children might be much more reserved. They like things nice and calm. They like to kind of ride things out. So they might be the children in the classroom who you are never worried about because they're not causing any disruption in your classroom because of their temperament, okay? Or is there something else going on why they're so withdrawn, but we write them off because they're not causing us any problems, so to speak, right now. Home environment can cause children's behaviors or delays. A couple of years ago, a project that I was working on in a Head Start in Boston, there was a little boy. He was 4 years old or so, and he would come in around 9 and he'd be asleep on a mat some days at like 9:30. And I remember talking to the teacher about like, wow, why is he so tired? You know, what's going on? Well, he actually lived in a homeless shelter. So he never got a good night's sleep. He didn't have that space of his own to have a good night's sleep. So that was affecting him physically during the day. So finding out that information. The school environment could also be a challenge too. Sometimes it's just not the right fit. Maybe the teacher and the temperament of the child doesn't work exactly. And I've seen that. You know, I've had a situation where I've had to help make the decision of moving a child from one classroom to another. And that child's behavior improved because the temperaments of the teacher and the child just did not sync. Or maybe it's that the classroom is too busy. There are too many children in the classroom, and that's just too overstimulating for a child. We can also look at knowledge and skills. Well, has that child even learned how to socially interact with another child? So maybe there's a new three-year-old to your program and they're struggling socially and you're concerned. Well, if they've never been in childcare before and they've been home for the first 3 years, one-on-one with a grown-up, they may not have learned the skills that they need that other children already in your classroom know. So do we need to teach them something first? And lastly, environmental needs. So could be similar to those that we talked about in school and home environment. But this may again be things such as if a child has a hearing disability. We had a classroom where we needed to add more rugs in the classroom because of his hearing aids. There was a lot of echo in the classroom because they had just the laminate type of floors and only a few area rugs. So we needed to put extra rugs in this room. Again, it could be that the room is just, you know, too busy and hectic. You know, maybe a child physically needs more space to maneuver around the classroom, whether that's because of physical disability, maybe it is a sensory where they are just not in tune with where their body is in space. And we need to create an easier blueprint for them to get through the classroom. So again, we want to think about lots of different reasons why a child may be behaving the way they are or delayed the way they are. And not just jump to the conclusion that there is something wrong, but more so, is there something we can do? I have a question here. I just want to read this. Let's see. If we do notice something not right with the child's development, autism, et cetera, how do we proceed to tell the parents without offending them? Great question. And we're going to get to that in just a minute because that's difficult. Let me close that out. All right. So again, your role here is to look for and note each child's developmental milestones. So you all have different requirements within your states that say you need to write progress reports or evaluation reports for children. Here in Massachusetts, it's twice a year for preschool and older. It is in toddlers, and it is every 3 months for infants and children with special needs. So that is a state requirement. But sometimes, you know, it's hard based on staffing and the job that you have as a teacher coordinating everything, that when you get to evaluation time, you're trying to rush through and write all these notes and, you know, do the best you can. But what I want to encourage is finding a way that works for you as a teacher or as a program to make sure that you're making notes about each children's progress over time. So when it gets to the point of you writing a progress report, is accurate. You can really look back and really see, when did they start using single words, or how have they been doing with their social engagement and their ability to ask questions of the teacher or so forth. You can see a timeline of how a child has either progressed or sometimes regressed, and you can pinpoint that information and really work with it and see what else is going on at that same time. Again, then we're going to share that information with parents, and I'm going to talk again more specifically about this in just a little bit. And lastly, encourage parents to talk to their child's doctor, or it could be that you connect them right to the school system, depending on what the concern is. So again, you want to write what you see happening with children, compare it against developmental norms. You want to share those facts, those nice, clear, objective facts that you have with parents, and encourage them to seek out the supports that they need and be there for them along the way. And when I'm talking about, you know, what we need to write down for children, you know, concerned about what is typical for each child, we want to keep in mind that normal range of development. And you probably learned that way back in, you know, child development 101, when you were preparing to become an early childhood teacher. But basically it's saying that children progress at their own pace. We know that we need to give them time to grow, and not every child is going to start the same skill at the exact same time, but that there is a range of time in which children will develop typical skills to be considered typically developing. So walking is one example of that. Typically, children will learn to walk between 9 and, you know, 18 months. So if they start walking at any point in time between this range, that is considered normal or typical. All right. If they're walking sooner than 9 months, wow, well, that is advanced. And those parents are going to need to lock down their house and make sure all their plugs are covered up and so forth, and their safety techniques are implemented throughout the house. So we're not going to worry about that. But if they're 18 months or older and they're still not walking, that's a red flag. Because again, research shows that it's that 9 to 18 months that would be considered typical or normal for children to develop the skill of walking, okay? I have a great nephew who is now 13, a little over 13 months old. He's still not walking. I'm not really concerned. I saw him yesterday and he is crawling around everywhere. He is pulling up on the couch and scooting along. So he's got a lot of other great motor skills that are getting him ready to walk. So I definitely wouldn't be concerned because he's, you know, 1 month past a year old and not walking yet. I think he'll get there. But again, let's watch and make sure. So when you're doing your documentation, there are lots of different tools that you can use. Some of you might use ages and stages or teaching strategies gold. Some of you might have evaluation reports that your own program writes up based on maybe American Pediatrics or another good resource. And some of you may use CDC information. Now, CDC has enacted a really great program over the last few years. I don't remember exactly what year, but really making sure that we are watching children's development and making sure that they're meeting milestones. But whatever system you use, you want to use it consistently and over time. You know, what's today's date? What is this child doing? You know, are they walking? Are they picking up a crayon and drawing circles? Are they potty trained? You know, what are some of the things you see children doing? Give a little notice to how you see that happening. If there's something of concern, write that down with a question mark. And just, again, the next week or the next month, are we seeing progress here? Are we seeing any type of growth? Are we seeing regression? Is there time to talk to a parent now? We want to make sure that we have that conversation before, you know, the child goes further down the time period without getting the proper support. Whatever you use it consistently. And again, you want your documentation to tell a story over time. So using things like the CDC charts or ages and stages, where it gives you the milestones that you're looking for, and you can basically check off yes or no if they're doing them. You can write little anecdotal notes to make sure that you're giving a good example of, you know, how you see a child succeeding or where you see them struggling. I want to definitely share the CDC ones here today because these are free and they have a great setup that allows you to use this information to track milestones, but also share with families. So someone had asked about communicating with families. This is the first step I want to really share with you, is when you're going to talk to a family about a concern you have, having information such as comparison in terms of what you see their child doing and a quality resource that should identify where your child should be at their age, I think is great reinforcement, great support for you to, you know, make your argument that you have a concern that this child really should be evaluated, and you're using very validated, qualified resources to support your concerns, and you have the notes to kind of back that up to show you, show parents what you mean. So go to this one again. All right, I'm going to actually click on the CDC website just for a moment here. And that should have popped up on your screen here. So just really quickly, I like to show you, when you get to the CDC developmental milestones page, you can see that you can click on a list of milestones for all of these various ages. They're one pagers. You can, again, check off where you see a child progressing, identify some of the red flags. I just clicked on the 9-month one here. Let me see. I'm gonna go into, oh, you know what I want to see is this PDF one. All right, so you can see here's my 9-month CDC checklist. You can use this as some of your documentation tool. Put dates or put check marks on here to see how a child is progressing over time. All right, you can make a copy and share this with parents so that you can say, hey, I wanted to have a conversation with you about your child's speech and language. As I was making observations over the last month or so, these are the things I noticed. And these are some of the areas I may have a concern about. And I'm going to share this documentation with you to help you understand why I think it might be important for you to talk to the special education department or your pediatrician, whoever it might be. So this can help you communicate information without, I know the concern and the question was insulting parents or offending parents. We're approaching it with a, you know, strength-based approach. This is where I see your child striving, but I also want to make sure you know these areas and I want to make sure we're supporting your child in going forward. So hopefully that helps with some of that question, but we still will talk more. On this website too, you can also get little video clips that shows children interacting in a successful way, meeting a particular milestone. These are great things that you could link into your communication tools with parents, drop these little video links in, or share one of these PDFs with. It could be for all of your families. You know, you have a group of older infants that you just like to send out information each month so that parents can watch some of the milestones their child are making and really know what a big success that is. There's also an app that parents can put on their phone and they can mark off the progress that their child's making and really have some information right in the palm of their hand to say, hey, my child's doing great. Or hey, when I go to the pediatrician next month, I'm gonna ask them about X, Y, and Z. All right. So again, you're doing this documentation, and I reviewed all those puzzle pieces so that you can kind of think, hey, what's going on? Is there anything I can do to support this child? Because before jumping into, oh my gosh, we need to have them evaluated, sometimes there's things that we can do just to support them right in our classroom, and that's all they need. So for example, you have an infant that's not holding their head up steadily and, you know, very floppy, you know, doesn't really focus on other things around the classroom. As an educator, first thing, what can I do to help support the development of that skill? So in this situation, it may be making sure that that child has a lot more tummy time. All right, tummy time has been proven to be invaluable for children's development because it supports their whole motor development, their neck development, their arm development, gets them ready for crawling. And maybe we need to make sure that they have the opportunity to work those neck muscles by giving them lots of tummy time and putting really attractive toys and materials right in front of them so that they are looking towards them, they are reaching towards them. And let's see if that does anything to support the progress there. You might have a toddler that's not responding to your requests. And I know you might be thinking none of your toddlers respond to requests because they're one, they're two, that's what they do, okay? But maybe this one is a little bit more concerning. So before you start expressing that as a concern to parents, maybe you try a few different approaches with them. Maybe you use something that helps get their attention when you're giving an announcement to the class. That might be a chime. So a nice clear sound that children associate with pausing. I know the teacher's going to talk next. It may be coming up and making sure you're talking face to face with a child. So you might talk to the group, but they're still a little distracted, walking over to them and saying, you know, hey, Mary, you know, one more minute and we're going to clean up. Okay. It may be something like, can you tell me what I just said? And having them recall what you told them and just practicing those skills of listening. You know, children don't always just learn to listen until we help them really focus in on, I said something, what does that mean? All right, documenting this all along the way. You might have a preschooler who doesn't sit for circle. Now, my daughter was one of those who didn't sit for circle. She ultimately did have a diagnosis of sensory integration disorder. So sitting in that crowd was really difficult for her. But before she was even diagnosed with this disorder, the teachers were great about giving her space. She would go and sit at the table and work on a puzzle, but she was still listening. So later on, they might be talking about something that happened during circle, and she was still in tune with what was happening because she could be away from the group and listen. But when she was mixed in the group, that's when she had a harder time listening because she was too overwhelmed, you know, in a sensory way. It was physically too many people around her. However, there's also things that sometimes we have to do a little self-reflecting. Is my circle time engaging enough? I've heard teachers who say, I'm going to stop circle time. The children don't listen. They don't sit. Maybe the expectation is too much for what you have going on in your circle time. Maybe you're not meeting the children's needs. They need something that's a little more active, a little more interactive with you, and maybe less passive. You know, maybe we're not meeting their needs quite as much as we should be. So maybe that could be the factor. But play around with it. What can you do? You know, what are some of the accommodations you might be able to try out first and foremost? Because again, it'll either support or become part of that documentation that you share with parents to say, I want to let you know I've tried A, B, and C, and I haven't seen any progress just yet. All right. So that question, talking to parents, how do we go about doing this without upsetting them? The reality is parents are going to be upset in one way or another. Because when we have our children, we hope that they grow up to be perfect and happy and successful and, you know, have great relationships. And when someone tells us that maybe there's something going on with our child and they may need services, that they're not developing at the right pace, that is just hard for any parent to hear. All right. So know that. So the first thing to do is build relationship with parents, all right? When they're dropping off, when they're picking up, have those conversations, build the trust, let them know how much you care about their child, identify the amazing things their child is doing. And also talk about development regularly. Let parents know that you're picking up on, wow, I noticed your child do this today. Send them out those CDC pieces or other checklists that you might have or bits of information that help parents understand what to expect of their child over a period of time. Make that the norm, okay? So that, again, having these conversations doesn't become awkward because you're always talking about children and how they're developing. Again, share the resources. So this doesn't mean you have to share the resource only to the parent you have a concern about, but you should always be sharing resources. If you have a monthly newsletter, put in an email link. If you are using apps to communicate with parents, again, stick the link to a video in there and just say, hey, watch as your child is ready to, you know, learn XYZ. You know, or make a photocopy of great resources, great article, and send it out. Do that regularly. So parents, again, are used to hearing information about children's progress and what to expect. You also want to use really good listening skills, okay? Because it's not just about giving information to parents, but listening to the concerns that they have and helping them through this process. Again, letting them know what you've been doing to support their child, but listening to them share maybe the struggles they have at home, their concerns possibly with the special education process. I had one parent who was adamant not to have his child evaluated because he was in special education as a child. And that was probably back in the 70s, early 80s. And special education has changed since then. It has come a long way since then. However, this parent's understanding and association with special education was negative. So he didn't want his child in any way, shape, or form connected to it. And by that, that was slowing down the process of getting his son the support that he needed. You know, so how can we listen to parents' concern and then again, give them support that they need too? Always highlight a child's strength. It's not just about what a child can't do, but we should always be saying, you know, the wonderful things they did today. And maybe that is, you know, something like, I saw them making new squiggle marks on their paper. I can really tell their fine motor skills are developing. I noticed how they were holding the crayon differently today. That could be, wow. You know, the coolest thing happened between your son and so-and-so in the classroom. They built a block tower together. It was really an amazing time to see them collaborate. So we should always be highlighting those positive to parents along the way. Sometimes it's hard to pull out those positives if there's so many concerns right in front of us. But even the tiniest of steps can make a difference. So it could be that a child is going through a phase of biting and maybe they're biting multiple times a day. Well, the strength that day might be, you know what? I saw your child go to bite a child, you know, during free play and then backed off. I mean, that's amazing. That's showing some progress because things don't change, you know, overnight. We have to watch for those baby steps, you know, no matter what's going on with the child. And again, make sure you're well prepared. Have your notes that you've been taking, all of that documentation. Share those resources that you're making notes on. Again, if it's a CDC checklist, if it's ages and stages, if it's your own form, make sure you have that in writing so that when you meet with the parent, you can show them this information. Which always reminds me, anything you're writing down about a child, you always want to make sure you're writing it in a way that you could go ahead and photocopy and share it with the parents. So think of the way in which you word things. Think about, you know, how your spelling and grammar may be. And anything you write down at any point about a child should be able to be shared with parents. All right. You want to have that type of honest communication with families. You want to encourage the parent to share any concerns with the doctor. Again, it's not your role to diagnose. You're sharing the behaviors. I see them that they're not walking. I'm not hearing any words. I'm noticing that they're using aggressive techniques to engage with other children that they, you know, have not yet developed these social skills. I notice that there's no eye contact when we talk. You know, those are the things that you see and you experience in the classroom. You give that information and then let the parents provide that to the specialist. And also follow up. Just because you took these notes and passed it on to the parents doesn't mean you want to just, you know, wipe your hands of it, because you can be a huge support to parents. You can fill out evaluations that, you know, the specialist may give. You can let parents know that you'll join meetings with them to give them support, so they're not alone in a meeting overwhelmed with multiple specialists in the room. You can let parents know that you'll read anything that parents, you know, bring in from the specialist. You can identify what things you can use from a report to apply to your classroom to support that child. All right, so there's still a lot for you to do through this whole process as the child continues with you, even once you make that recommendation. All right, let's talk about what that process is really quick. We have a few more minutes. So first and foremost, the early intervention. So if you have a child that is under the age of 3 and you have a concern, a delay that you might be concerned about, something else going on, you want to talk to the parents. First things first, they make a referral, all right? We say, hey, I think you should be, you know, reaching out to early intervention and get an evaluation done. The parent calls the local organization that is responsible for early intervention in your area, and they'll conduct an intake. They'll ask you some questions. You know, they might have you fill out some forms. You know, has your child started walking? And then they start talking and various things like that. And they'll set up a time to come to your home and complete an evaluation. And that could be a couple of people at their program. They come in and in a playful way, watch your child and see how they're meeting certain milestones. All right. It's a very relaxed setting. If your child qualifies, then what they will do is set up an IFSP, which is Individualized Family Support Plan. And that is where they work with you as a family to set goals for your child and how you and early intervention together can help move your child forward. They'll set up services, and services are always done at home or, again, in the classroom environment. It is not a pull-out program. Early intervention should not be coming into your school, taking a child out of the classroom and providing services. The goal is to provide children in their actual daily setting. And then at key times, they will do reevaluations and review the child's IFSP. And when the child is 2.9, if the child still seems to need services, they will work with the family to work with the public school and have them evaluated there and see if they qualify for an IEP through the public schools. Sounds like a lot of steps, but I got to tell you, early intervention seems to work pretty quickly, and it seems to be a very easy process to get through overall. So great communication. And if you can understand the process, then you can help parents relax and understand the process as well. Now, once your child is 3 years or older, 2.9 generally or older, they would be evaluated by the public schools. All right. And the process is a little bit different here. You can see at the top left, there's that recognition that maybe the child needs some sort of support. Okay. Something may not seem to be developing the way it should be. So there's this pre-referral process. And this is where teachers may work together, maybe even talk with some of the specialists in the school and say, what are some of those things I can do to see if I can help this child move forward? That might be, again, that tummy time for an infant. You know, are there things that I need to be doing to enrich this environment? If you put those interventions into place and a child seems to progress, well, then you can see it on the far right here, the process stops. But if those interventions are not successful, that's when you'd want to make a referral to the school system. And this is where it gets a little overwhelming, but it shouldn't have to be. The parent needs to write a letter and send it into the public school stating, I want my child to be evaluated. Here is my concern. Once the school receives that, there starts a timeline, and we don't have time to go through all the timeline, but initially it is within 5 days that they need to get back to you to say, great, here's the paperwork to fill out. We're going to set a date. They have 30 days to get an evaluation completed after that, and that's school days, not vacation days, not weekends, any of that. And then they have 15 additional days beyond that, bringing it to 45 days to meet with you and go over the results of the evaluation. All right. Through that process, again, just from a parent writing a letter to the school, within about 45 school days, the evaluations should be completed. And this last section here on eligibility, a meeting should have happened with the family going over and identifying if your child qualifies for any special education or not. If they do not, again, a child will not receive services. That doesn't mean they don't qualify for a 504, which is different from different from an IEP, less intense, but they still may qualify for some types of supports in the classroom, or they qualify for an IEP, a special education plan for their particular needs. Okay. And then again, annually, and they will be reevaluated every 3 years. A full evaluation will be done to consider what needs your child still has and what services they qualify for. All right, I am past time, so I'm going to skip this last little video here. Move on. But remember, think of the program that you have. If you're using iCare right now, you're interested in using iCare, there are ways to document children's behavior and progress over time. There are ways to use this program to communicate with parents and even, you know, customize lesson plans so that you are incorporating what needs to happen in your classroom for particular children who you are currently caring for. Remember, the curriculum you wrote last year that might have been a success may need some adjustments for the children this year. We can't think that the same curriculum we use over and over again is going to always work. So there's lots to think about. If you have any questions about iCare, please feel free to reach out through our website, phone, email to get more information. Otherwise, I want to thank you for joining today, and I hope that you found the information helpful and that you'll join us again.